Ladies and gentlemen, welcome to episode 2 of D6, or as I have written in my notepad over here, Disastrous Decisions Done Deliciously, Dangerously, and Daringly. Or I guess you could say in any other fashion you think. But we're here, we're back with some more D&D adventures, but as a quick recap, this is where we are at this moment in time, from the last episode. Our party, that were originally stuck in the bottom depths of Malcomite Prison, are slowly working their way up. They ended up randomly meeting a elf inside of the prison that has been joining them all the way up, known as Arwen, and he has been helping them along the way. But on top of that, they accidentally killed a gnome who was in dwarven armor. They almost killed a dwarf who was sat on a chair throughout the entire battle. And on top of that, they annihilated a zombie and made their way up a flight of stairs while being chased by a gigantic tsunami of rats. But without further ado, let's get the party back together again, starting with Ryan, our barbarian dwarf.
Hi, my name's Ryan, and I am the drunken, glorious dwarf called...
And what did you learn last time, Ryan, after episode 1?
Beer is good.
Beer is good. You gotta love beer.
Beer is great.
As well as Ryan, we are also joined by our Dragonborn fighter, it's Jared.
Oi, hello there, guys.
I'm Jeff the Golden Hand Dragonborn.
Yes, I am Jeff the Golden Hand Dragonborn.
You've gotta do that every time now, you realise that?
Okay, I will.
And what did you learn, Jeff?
I learned two things.
Ooh.
One, make sure I don't use charisma, because that got a poor gnome killed.
Aww.
We have a zero roll. Yep. And two, not to waste a cone of cold.
Okay.
God damn your cone of cold.
Well said. Very well said. Then we have Craig, our gnome monk.
Hello again.
And what did you learn, Craig?
I'm not very good at golf.
Especially when golf's involving rats, by the looks of it.
Pretty much.
And last but not least, Dan, also Revan, the Death Knight.
Have you heard about the follow-up?
Many times. As at this point, I'm quite followed.
Oh, great. Like,
I'm at Twitter levels of following right now.
Yeah, follow the follower on Twitter, guys. Follow the follower on Twitter.
And it's an actual Twitter page. We made that specifically.
If you go to @the_D6_follower, and the follower will not follow you, but you will follow the follower.
Yeah.
Figure that one out.
Simple as. And Dan, as of last episode, what did you learn?
I can't fucking throw torches.
That's a fair
thing. And not to judge a conflict by... I almost killed a friendly dwarf.
Oh yeah, Will. Well, Arwen still feels bad about that.
Wasn't my fault.
It wasn't, because it was a different character that did it all in the first place. So there you go. But guys, we're back. You made it to the main chamber of the entryway to the prison. Arwen is trying to work his way to open that door, the main door, out of the building. And of course, you have now been approached by the son of Shockjammer and his left and right hand guards. It is dangerous, it is not looking great, but it was leading up to battle. So bearing in mind at this point in time, Jared, you're with Arwen at this point, just looking on, mostly just looking at the fact that Dan is trying to give a pamphlet of the follower.
Yeah.
To the son of Shockjammer with Craig still underneath his arm, just saying, "If you're not interested, Dan, I can offer the dwarf, offer the gnome, no, that way."
Then you can do it.
That's whilst Arwen's trying to mess with the door, and while this is happening, because I remember this from last episode, Ryan, you're just like looking around the place, going, just having a casual whistle and a casual look around, saying, "I'm not part of this, guys. It's fine. I'm just twiddling my thumbs. It's all good."
until I rudely interrupted.
All of this is happening. The battle is about to commence, but before you roll for initiative, the son of Shockjammer, he stands up towards Revan's face. All whilst like the gnome is still underneath his arm, and the gnome's just like, "Can you just carry on already? Like, get started?" And he just looks at you and, and just literally says, "You are about to face the wrath of Garfield Von Shockjammer."
Garfield. Do you like lasagna, by any chance?
Shut up! It was a name given to me by my father. Stop making fun of me.
Ah, oh, but wait.
I think
Shockjammer
you may
want
to change it.
Oh, God. So, as you guys are laughing your heads off and just totally going to each other, going, "His name's Garfield."
Garfield.
You know what it's time for, guys? Roll for initiative!
Whoa, boy! Hey.
20. Oh. Oh, boy!
I rolled 19 plus 1, so I'm also at 20.
Oh, nice.
11 for myself.
12.
I did not roll a 20. I wish I had.
What did you get?
Oh, two.
Two?! What?!
Let the bad rolls come in.
Okay, so Shockjammer's first guard rolled a 2. So he's not with it. Well, wow, the second guard rolled a 3. He's definitely not with it.
Whoop.
And then Shockjammer himself, he got a 12, so that's not too bad. So Garfield's on 12. But before the battle commences, Arwen's tampering at this door, and as he is, he hears a really strange noise coming from the other side of the door. There just seems to be a sss noise from the other side of the door. He quickly looks towards you, Jared, and just says, "My friend, quickly, jump back! I know who's behind this door!"
Okay.
So, Jared, I want you, alongside of Arwen, because I'm going to be throwing this, to do me a dexterity saving throw.
13.
So you land it, and you're perfectly fine. Arwen, on the other hand, doesn't jump far enough, and gets caught in this big explosion that involves the door just being exploded out from his hatches, flying to the other side of the room. And as it's flying across to the other side, Arwen just gets his leg caught by the flying door, and it's just like, "Argh!" Massive banshee cry in the room, and he loses 4 HP because of
ouch.
That.
Ooh.
So he is now on 16 HP before the battle's even started. But when this door explodes, the dust slowly settles, and as it does, from behind the door reveals 3 new characters into the fray. One person who seems to look like a necromancer, one who dons armor of a paladin, and another who seems to be wearing a weird leathery spandex suit.
Oh my god, it's Buddha Man. Buddha Man is coming to save us, guys. It's so good.
But guys, you are now introduced to our 3 new party members. Yay!
Yay. More
who the fuck are you
mustaches.
And what are you going for?
So let's introduce our new party members for the sake of the show. Starting off with Nathan.
Hello. I am Ziskin Belfalor, a mountain dwarf paladin, and some motherfucker killed my fiance. And people gotta pay.
Gotta pay.
So that sucks, dude.
Sucks, bro.
Six balls.
Okay. And next we have Cole.
Have no fear, Spooderman is here.
Really?
Nah, I'm joking. Cole. I'm also playing, the character Steven Silver. I'm a speedster. And, that's all I got for now.
And that pretty much sums it up. It's great. So he's super fast, guys. He's real fast.
He's super fast.
He's got fast.
Just for the lady.
And last but not least, we have Vinny.
Hi, I'm Bernard. I'm a half tiefling necromancer. I don't really talk about my past too much. All you need to know is I got 2 tattoos on my hands. They're my powers, basically. Am I next to a paladin? Oh god.
And these 3 new party members are entering the fray of the battle. So, what I want you 3 to do is, I want you 3 to roll for initiative as well and tell me what you get.
Bloody hell, 22.
Oh. Five.
Five.
I rolled a 22.
Cole, how about you?
So did he get a natural 20 then?
Yeah, what's that, a natural 20?
D20, right?
I rolled a 20 and I got plus 2 on my modifier.
So you got a critical.
Critical!
It's burner time!
It's burner time.
What one am I looking for again?
You're rolling a D20, Cole.
Yep, but what on?
On
your dex modifier.
Well, on. Is it dexterity? 18 plus 4.
Okay, so.
So add 4 to your dice.
12. So, that's 16.
Alright, cool. Nice one. Okay, so, with initiative done, it's time to go in order of who's going first. And guess what? Vinny, as you come out of this door, you're attacking first. And obviously when you right. reveal yourself to be a necromancer, everyone's just looking at you going, is he actually a fucking necromancer? Like, what the fuck is this?
Okay. First of all, is there anything undead in the room at all? Anything?
No.
And that's true. No, anything.
He's undead in the soul!
Nice. Doesn't quite work.
Don't even think about it.
It's like, I know someone will be dead in a minute, Garfield.
So Garfield. Where's the paladin in the room compared to me?
So, like, you, the paladin, and the speedster have literally just come out of the staircase. And so on the left of you is Jared, who just jumped out of the way, who is trying to console Arwen, who got his legs shacked by the door. And then Ryan are a little bit to the ways more to the left of where they are, and on your right you have Dan the Death Knight holding the gnome underneath his arm still, as Shockjammer with his hammer and shield and his two left and right hand guards are just literally looking at you guys going, did they just blow through that door?
Right, okay, my first, alright, so can I move and then do something?
Yes.
Is that how it works? Yeah.
He's within range for you to move and do it, so yeah.
I'm going to run as far away as I can from the paladin, right. And then throw a dagger at the right-hand knight.
Ooh, okay. Let's go for it. Roll me a d20 on that throw.
Right, so what's that d20 plus my... Would that be dexterity?
That what? Would be, yes.
All right, I rolled 16.
16 to hit.
Plus... It's plus 2 on my dexterity.
Alright.
That?
That's an 18, then.
So, yep.
Alright, so you throw the dagger to the... Was it the left-hand or the right-hand guy?
Right-hand guy.
Okay. Threw the dagger of the right-hand guy. Right-hand guy literally just sees the dagger coming, but doesn't move away in time or raise up his shield high enough. And that dagger just digs into the odd bit of the collar where his armor's not defending his neck and is now just dug in there. And he's just going, oh god! And the left-hand guy's like, yo, Barry, you alright? No, I'm not alright! I've got a freaking dagger in my neck! And this is when Garfield just looks to the back and says, stand up, you idiot! You're making me look like a fool! But now roll for damage.
Garfield, your name already does that.
That's like 6 damage in total.
Right, 6.
Yeah.
So he's taken quite a bit of a hefty blow. He went down on one knee with this dagger stinging into his collar as he's now screaming at his allies, just complaining that, oh, I wasn't paid enough for this, and things along those lines. And you've hit him really well, so great first move on that one. Really nice. Next to go is Dan.
Okay.
So, bearing in mind, Dan, you've got a dwarf under your arm. You've got...
Not a dwarf, a gnome!
Gnome, under your arm.
Okay. That's basic.
Hey, gnome, it's time to wake up.
Nice.
I'm going to... headbutt Shockjammer.
Oh.
Square in his face.
Okay, right. Roll me a d20 on the headbutt.
15. What am I adding to it?
Your strength modifier.
So 18.
So you literally go up to Shockjammer. This is like, follow this headbutt right into his face. He like you smack him into his face. he grabs on to his forehead. He's like, ah, and he's actually taken a few steps back out of the sheer force that this headbutt was. Roll me a d4's worth of damage.
A d4? I rolled a 2.
A 2? Okay. So he's obviously reeled back by the headbutt, but he's not reeled back enough to the extent where he's going to take serious damage. He's more pissed off than anything else. But he's allowed himself to be headbutted by who he deems to be unworthy at this point.
Is it possible to follow up with that, or...?
You have part of your action left. You can't hit him again, but you can do something else. So, like, move around. You could potentially throw the gnome?
I was just about to throw the gnome!
Do you wish to throw the gnome?
Who's furthest away?
So much like a euphemism.
So at this moment in time,
furthest away from Shockjammer.
So from where you are right now, Shockjammer's reeled back a little bit from where you were, giving you some more room. And about 10 feet to the left of you is the guy that was hit by Vinny's dagger, who's just kneeling with the dagger still in his collar at this point. And on the other side is the other guard, just looking at now Shockjammer and the other dude, saying, "Oh God, I hope I'm not targeted next."
Who's the furthest ally away from Shockjammer?
That would be Ryan, who's literally on the other side of the room.
Is it possible to throw the gnome to Ryan like a rugby ball?
Just swing me okay, like a so, bat already.
Okay, so Dan, I want you to roll me a d20.
I'm so sorry if I just throw you at the floor.
We'll see how this goes.
I'm assuming this is plus my strength modifier.
This is actually plusing your dex because you're throwing him.
Okay, that's an 8 plus 1, so that's a 19.
Nice. So you take your gnome friend, you pull him up to where your shoulder is, you take your other arm out just to roughly estimate as to how far Ryan is, and you just shout out to Benwick. You're just like, "Benwick, hut hut!
Go long!"
And you just chuck the gnome over the room. Now Ryan, I need you to roll a d20 and roll with your strength modifier to see if you catch the gnome.
Oh good god.
Here we go.
I got 17 plus my strength modifier, which gives me a grand total of 20.
So you see him coming, and you're just like, "I got it."
Can I just let those step out the way just for shits and giggles, though?
Really? Do you actually want to do that?
I will catch the gnome. Just like, because it's like a whoa, thinking. I was like, just catch it. So I will catch the gnome.
Alrighty. So you're just like shaking to the left, shaking to the right, trying to get into the right place. He was like, "Ah!" And you grab him. Plus one gnome.
That's like, look at the gnome like, "Sup?"
And then, put me down.
To the side.
Back in his hometown, he was proficient in gnome rugby.
To the sidelines, you just see Jared and Arwin, who just saw this, and Arwin just pulls out a little board from his coat, presumably has a 10 on it, and sticks it up. Great stuff. I love that. Okay, so Dan, that's your turn.
Okay.
Now we move on to Cole. It's your turn to do something.
Well, I don't know what to do. I think I might follow up with Dan on the in for a hit.
Okay, so you're gonna dash up to Garfield and smash him in the face. Okie doke. Using your initial action, you do dash over to where Garfield is. Like, "Hey, it's me." And then you just go in for like one of those quick, sharp jabs to the gut just to open him up. Roll me a d20 for the hit.
I got a 9. What's that plus?
You see on the sheet where it says attack bonus? You add that.
Attacks and spellcasting.
Oh, okay, so it's attack bonus plus 6. So 9 plus 6 is...
15.
There you go.
Nice one. Okay, so you go to hit him in the gut with your super fast speed, but as you do, you didn't calculate the chances that Shockjammer, because he's been wild back by this headbutt, might actually have his shield up at this point on his other arm. And you punch straight into his shield. It doesn't hurt you that much, because of course you being a speedster, you just smash into his shield, look at your fingers that are kind of like broken and twisted. You just go, it's all right, guys. It's all fixed up.
Cool.
So that did no damage, but you're perfectly fine with how you are. And now you're standing pretty much right in front of where Garfield is right now, in comparison to the rest of the room. So that's your turn.
I'm back.
Nice one. next up. Right, because Jared and Shockjammer has the same number of roll. Jared, what I want you to do, we're going to have a d20 dice off to see who goes first out of the two of us. So you roll a d20, I roll a d20. Whoever rolls highest goes first.
I have a 2.
And I have a 16.
I called DM hacks.
It's not DM hacks. I'll put it up to the screen just to clarify. 16. Okay?
I jest.
It's all good. So, Shockjammer goes first. What he's going to do is he's pissed off that obviously the Death Knight in front of him's headbutted him. He's kind of looked to one side of the speedster and thought, I knew what you were planning. So, okay, so let me get this straight. I'm being headbutted by a Death Knight who just literally threw a gnome to the other side of the room, and I just tried to get punched by a man in spandex. Who the hell are you people?
We're not the lasagna.
We're not edible.
Okay, fair enough. And so Garfield, at this point in time, he has a shield, he has a mini golden one-handed hammer, and he looks towards Revan, and he just goes, I'll show you how to butt with hammer! And he's gonna roll for it. And what's your AC, Dan?
15.
That's... So he goes to swing at you with the hammer that he has one-handedly. Comes down, swings it, plans to hit it onto your shoulder, and you literally see it coming from a mile away and just move your shoulder back a slight bit and just go, what, mate?
Fam.
As if it's like, what the hell? But what he does, because he realizes he missed that, he'll step back a little bit, going back to his comrade with the dagger. It's just shoved in his collarbone. He keeps the dagger in because he completely understands that if he takes it out, he could die of blood loss. So he keeps it in there and just helps him get up and just say, come on, you're part of my royal guard. Get in there and get your own back. And if you know that reference from a famous game show when you were a kid, good, nicely done.
Nice.
Right, so Jared, it's now your turn.
All right. Can I use the blowgun that I carry?
You can.
Okay, so I'm rolling a D1 for it, so it's already a 1. I get plus 2 piercing and a plus 4 attack damage. Attack bonus, sorry. Making it 7.
Right, no, you roll a d20 and just add your attack bonus on top.
Alright. We have, in total, 11.
And who are you shooting at?
Shockjammer.
Oh, you're shooting at Garfield. Very nice.
Yes,
I'm shooting at... So you get your little blowgun out, and you're just like, and you aim it towards where, like, Shockjammer is, and then all you just see is that the dart just gets waved, in, like, just seamlessly just goes through the side of Shockjammer's beard, just out the other end, and just sticks out to the back of a wall, and Garfield's just seen this go through his beard, and he's like, what school of aiming did you go to, Dragonborn?
Not a very good one, clearly.
So that was your attack, but do you want to move around at all, like try and get closer? Because you're about, from how big the room is, if you moved, you wouldn't be close enough to attack Shockjammer or any of the guards physically at this moment in time, but if you move now, you'll be closer so that next time you can get in there.
yeah, I'll move. I'll move as close as I can get to Dan, I guess.
Okay, so basically you're about like 5-7 odd feet behind Dan at this point, and you're just standing there ready to back him up in case shit happens. So you're ready to go. Right, who is next on said list? Let's go. We have Ryan. It's time for you. Bearing in mind, you now have a gnome in your hands.
I have a gnome in my hands.
Hello again.
I'd be like, there is a gnome in my hands. What do I do with it? Gnome, what should I do with you?
Throw me at them.
You want me to throw you at them?
Yes. Do it.
do it.
Second, do you want me to throw it at? Do you want me to throw it at Garfield, or do you want me to throw it at the squad?
Block bladder.
So you want me to throw you at the other dwarf?
No, Garfield.
Garfield. Okay.
Yeah.
Garfield. Right, I want to take a swig. Don't mind me, dwarf. I'm sorry. I'm gonna just take a swig for this. This is gonna be a momentous victory. This is. So what I'm gonna do is gonna take a swig of my famous alcohol beer that I carry on my back,
nice.
And then line up this shot to try and throw him towards him. It's like, go long.
Awesome. Right, because you drank your beer, I want you to roll me a d20, but with advantage. So I want you to roll two d20s and the highest score wins.
My first one is 11, and my second one is a 15.
And then add your strength on top of the highest.
The strength of plus 3, so 15, 16, 17, 18.
And you're throwing a shock jammer, right?
Towards Shockjammer, yes.
Okay, so you've just thrown the gnome at this point. Gnome is now in midair, flying over like just flying on over. And you're just watching as he goes on. A little bit drunk in your stance, you're like fly. Now that was your actual action. I'll let you move if you want to, because bearing in mind you're on the other side of the room at this point.
Can I run towards the group then?
Yes, you can.
Oh, hang on. Is it possible to run towards him in a rugby stance? So I'm like crouched down and just like, come on and have some! And just basically run towards him as a rugby stance?
You can do. Bearing in mind, because you've already used one of your actions at this moment in time, and now you really only have a move action. You'll be going, and then partway through, just stopping, just go.
That makes perfect sense, because then you have just drunk alcohol. It makes
sense. You're all bloated, and you just get halfway there, and it's like,
Okay, so you want to do that, yeah?
Yeah, it's really just like, it's summer, just will start pelting towards you, and like, oh, actually, guys, you know what? Give me a minute, I'll be right there.
Okay, so to put you into perspective as to where you are in the room, you've ran up looking as if you're going to be doing the manliest tackle ever, and you've just paused to catch your breath, maybe have another extra swig of your ale, and Arwen's just kind of there, like just massaging his leg that got whacked, just going, oh hey.
I have a question.
Yes.
Why do you drink so much alcohol? I hear that it's bad for you and you get very dehydrated very fast.
Fuck you! Alcohol's the best! The best thing that's ever happened to this fair kingdom! I seek to find the finest of alcohol that is seeking throughout these lands, and I will seek it until the very bitter end, so you can go nap yourself, because booze is great. Booze is good.
Alright.
I prefer apple juice.
Beam is good.
I would happily drink the most glorious of ales in this fair kingdom.
Okay, so at this moment in time, because this is happening in real-time state, you guys are having this shouty go at each other with ale, whilst Gnome is in mid-flight still, and then the next person to move, like, he's got some serious airtime. He's a monk anyway, he's kind of used to it. But
just seen him spinning his hair like a little whistling, like...
I just imagine he's gone around the room four or five times in a circle.
But next in the fray is Nick.
Oh, oh my, no.
Our paladin.
Literally just orbiting the room right now.
Right, so I'm assuming the only guard, like, the only person that has not actually been attacked yet is the guard that's on the left?
Right.
Right?
Yeah, the one that's to the right of you.
The one to the right of me?
Yes.
Right. So I'm just going to take a step forward and I'm going to try and cut his head off.
Right, so bearing in mind you're at the doorway at this point, he's a way off. And in order to get to him, you will need to charge, which will mean that you won't, you would basically use your one action, like your big move.
Yeah, my
in this
full
case,
move and
just
attack.
To
yeah,
get
I want to do that.
Yeah.
Oh wait, so I use my full turn just to get there, or I can move there and attack in the same turn?
You because of your speed, you're moving just to get there.
Okay.
So you're just gonna be like,
so far.
Like your holy battle axe in hand, you'll just run on over to the guys. It's like, you're next! In the name of my lord, I'm going to hit you! When I catch my breath.
I'm not even like running, I'm just kinda like waddling.
It's like, when I get there, I'm gonna hit you so hard.
Okay, that's
well, at least Ryan's happy if there's another dwarf now.
Whee!
So that's a good thing.
Why did he have to be a paladin?
It's fine. Right, so, next up to the fray. Right, it's Craig in midair versus Grunt 1, so...
If this
ends up
working.
So roll a d20, Craig, and I'll roll one, see who gets to go first out of two of us.
9.
16.
Damn it!
Oh dear. Well, you said to throw you, so I threw you.
So,
he's gonna do another 2 minutes in flight.
So, Grunt, to put into perspective, Grunt 1 is the guy that had the dagger shoved in his collar. So, he's happy that Garfield's helped him up. He's now inspired by his royal leader to go in there and try to get his own back. So he's looking, although he wants to get his own back on the necromancer, he knows his tiny little dwarven feet are not going to get him that far. So instead, he just looks at Revan, just goes, I will avenge you, Lord Shockjammer! And just runs at him with a big hammer in hand, about to swing it down. Let's see what happens. Wow. I'm showing this to the screen because this is a first for the DM. Ladies and gentlemen, we have a critical fail!
Critical fail!
Critical
fail?
So he's running at you. He's running at you with his big hammer saying, I will avenge you, Lord Shockjammer! And he doesn't realize that his Lord Shockjammer's boot is in the way as he's running and basically collapsed head first with his hammer in two hands. And is now just laying prone on the floor, just going. So he's now prone. So if any of you guys were to attack him now, you get advantage on hitting him.
I'm still halfway across the room at the moment, so.
I just thought.
So bearing in mind, what this has all happened. Craig is now falling towards Shockjammer. Craig, it's your turn.
I just imagine Craig gets on a sort of loop.
I'm still flying.
You're still flying.
As I get to Shockjammer,
yep.
I want to jump, and just jump off of him.
Right.
But I jump in the direction of the grunt who just fell over.
Right.
Directly above him.
Right. I want you to roll me a d20 for acrobatics.
Damn it. Oh, no, please, no.
It's a zero.
Acrobatics. 9, 10, 12.
So you got this whole idea in your head that you're gonna, like, get on top of Shockjammer some way, just hop off of him towards his down dude to do something crazy on him. But what happens is, you end up jumping onto Shockjammer. You're basically have your nuts in his face as you've grabbed both sides of his helmet. You're just like, hello! So you are now on Shockjammer's face and he's now wailing about going, oh, get the gnome off of me! Get him off of me! Get him off! So now you're stuck on Shockjammer, but I'm counting what you were hoping to do as a bonus action because you were in mid-flight. So now that you're on Shockjammer, what do you want to do?
All right. So if I jump off him now, that would be an action.
If you were to jump off him now, yes.
No, wait. I think I can still do this. Ooh. All right. I want to jump off him anyway.
Right.
Do I need a backpack or not?
No, you're fine. Because you're closer to the ground now, so that's perfectly fine.
Do the exact same jump
that
I wanted to do, and as I go down directly on this on flanker.
Oh right, yeah.
Do my bonus action for an unarmed strike.
Okay, yeah.
Just massive, just punch him straight.
So,
in his back.
So is this the downed guy?
Yes.
Okay, so roll me 2d20s, highest one wins. Plus any bonuses you get for your unarmed strike.
The unarmed strike is just 1d4. Well, I still need. Okay, so 2d20s. That's 10 plus 2, 12, or 14. So 14 is the highest. I don't get any.
So you jump off a shock jammer, you're just like, sorry for the teabag, jump on over to his buddy, and you're like, here comes! Like, go to punch his tailbone. But as you do, it seems like his armor's a little bit too strong for you. So you punch it, you leave a divot of your fist onto the armor, but then you realize you were just a little bit off from actually dealing damage from him. You're just,
damn it.
You're just looking at yourself disappointed, like, fist,
at least I look
why?
Cool.
Since he's still like crying.
And he's still crying on the floor going, Penny wants to punch me, David! He's just lost it at this point. He has gone back to kindergarten. He's not happy. It's sad times. But next up, it's Grunt 2. He was actually supposed to be going before you guys, but never mind. My mistake. Let's just go on anyway. It's Grunt 2 time. He has not been hit by this point. He's just looking at you guys. He has a paladin walking in his general direction. But what he does is, he looks towards Cole, the speedster, and is like, where did you get that latex?
Actually, it's a pretty light armor, not latex.
Either way, it's coming off! And he just runs to, like, takes...
Whoa, okay.
He takes a big jump, takes a big swing up with his hammer and tries to horizontally swing into your arm and probably your chest area. So he's going to roll for the hit. And what is your AC, Cole, your armor class?
17.
He hits you. It swings around, it batters the side of your chest, makes you careen back a little bit. It pushes you back a little bit as well, but you're able to hold your ground a little bit, but slightly hold onto your chest because you have been hit pretty badly. How much damage are we talking, though? Let's have a look. Because my god, this may be the first major bit of damage. Let's see. You take, from that blow alone, 6 points of damage.
Ooh! Ouch!
Oh, rip.
So, ouchie my ouch.
Yeah, ouchie my ouch.
And he's now just... He does that to you, is like really angry, but then realizes what he's just done. Turns over to Garfield as if to think, My master! I hit him! I hit! And he looks over and he's just got like the master with like a cloth trying to wash his face after the gnome's been teabagging him. And he's just like, oh, I'll never get approval this month. And we start from the top of the list again. So, Vinny. Vinny, is your go once more.
Right. How far away from the guards am I? Right. Who's the closest? Could I reach the right guard on the floor?
You have another dagger that you could... No, wait a minute. You've got your scythe, haven't you?
I've got my scythe, and I've got one dagger left, but I just want to keep hold of that one.
Your weapons would be able to reach him, yeah.
Right, okay. I'm gonna pull my scythe out, and I'm gonna rush towards this guard on the floor and take one great swing at his neck just to see if I can behead him. Oh. And I'm just wondering, I don't know if I'd be able to, but if I did behead him, would I be able to raise him?
Yeah, but that'll have to be your action when it's your turn again.
Next turn.
Yeah.
Yeah, all right. Yeah, so I'm going to go for that. I'm going to rush towards him, screaming with this scythe in my hands.
Leaving like a trail of shadow behind you and dark energies, channeling it into the scythe.
Bearing in mind, I'm only 5'7", so oh, yeah. I'm a, you know.
And roll that d20.
The wolf. I'm a short tiefling, I'm a tall dwarf, what can I say?
You're taller than a dwarf, that's what I said.
So what do I roll for my...
Roll your d20, and then you add on the attack bonus from your scythe.
I roll a 17 plus 4, 21.
Oh, nice.
Shit.
Well, you get your scythe, and you just ring and cut it down onto the neck, the perfect space between the back of his helmet and the back of where the back chassis piece of his armor begins. Roll that damage.
Right, I rolled... Is that 1d8 plus 2. I roll a 6 plus 2.
And with that,
8.
Your scythe. Like you just have the scythe up at your head at this point, as you just have a dark, as this gnome looks up with tears careening down his eyes, and he just sees...
That's not a gnome, that's a dwarf.
Sorry.
You see,
I'm getting it mixed up all the time. It's bad.
Can I make a really bad sort of one-liner just before I kill him?
Well, we've got a dwarf. I'll get you one-liner in just a sec. So the dwarf...
He's just sobbing there on the floor, and I just say, it's all business, really.
And upon hearing this, he's got tears running down his face a little bit. He turns a little bit, sees what he can only depict as a shade of death itself. And he's just like one little last screech we can all hear. And as your scythe comes down and freaking, and you just hear this big slashing gunch of a blow onto the back of his neck. You just suddenly just... Everyone just careens back a little bit, just going, oh! As his head just starts rolling away from his body. That is one grunt dead.
Can I kick it at Shockjammer?
Football! Go along!
Well,
The fun part is, Dan, it is your turn next, so if you want to do that, you can.
Would that be considered my action?
I'll give you that as a bonus action because I was not thinking that as an idea.
Could I kick the dwarf's armored head at Shockjammer?
Roll me a d20 plus your dex.
Plus my dexterity.
Man, you say, yeah, man, on the head.
I rolled a 5 plus 1.
Six.
Oh god, So you line yourself up for a ball. It's like a classic crossing from like a football match. And all you just have in the background, you just have like a mini commentary in your head. Just going, oh, it's a crossing. It's lined up. He's going for the boot. And you completely miss the head in its entirety. Just like, ooh, that cost him a match. Just that commentator voice in your head just ringing.
Like sniffing on the banana skin or something.
And everyone is just looking at you and you just hear like this odd like, cricket in the background sounding off.
Just slow clapping in the distance.
So now do you actually want to do something?
Try
it again.
Can I draw a mustache on the seven head?
As it's rolling.
Could I just, like, summon my greatsword to my hand and, like, point it at the other guard and turn, like, trying to intimidate him?
Sure thing. Do you want to actually intimidate him in a way so that he's, like, hesitant to approach you?
Move and you die.
Right, roll me a d20 on my intimidation.
Like your friend.
Oh, wow. Natural 20.
Critical!
Nice.
Plus my intimidation of plus 6, so that's a
26. 20. My god. So you shove this greatsword of it. So, like, you channel your greatsword to your side, and first off, it's like as if you've got both hands with a greatsword in front of you, as if you're, like, preaching to it. And then this dwarf is looking at you, thinking, what's this guy planning? Hammer ready with a shield. Your head just slowly turns towards him as you take your sword in one hand and stick it towards his general direction. What do you say to this dwarf?
You move and you die, just like your friend.
And as soon as he looks at you with that guise, he literally just like he just goes,
"Mommy!"
And like he, and out of pure shock, he completely drops his large hammer that he had in both of his hands. So he is now weaponless. So that was only part of your action because you haven't moved. But because you haven't attacked either, you can either move or you can attack.
Could I just take, like, one stomping step towards him and...
like, a short stomp?
Just one, like, do you know, like, the, you what, mate? Just, like, a lurch towards him. Just to add, like...
I bet you do it!
So, like, I'll do that, like, I'll take that as your other action. Because yes, this is a full intimidation thing.
That's
so,
fine.
With this sword stuck at him, now you just put it back into your two arms, go into a battle stance, and just go, and, like, take that one big intimidating step forward. And he's just like, puts his arms up, the shield flies to the ceiling, and it's just flown across the room, so now he's lost his shield. And he is now facing backwards, away from you all, ready to run for his life. You have intimidated the dwarf.
Yep.
So, next on the list is Cole.
Hey, yeah.
So, you're hurt a little bit. You got hammered. But what do you want to do?
It's quite ironic that I would be the one that gets hammered, not the drunkard one. What do I think about this tactically to try and help out the rest of the team? Like, say if I were to run around the room and make sure all the Shockhammer couldn't get away, or the last remaining guard that basically has just been threatened by Dan.
Well, I kind of wanted him to run away.
Yeah, but I know. Like, do you want him to literally run away from the, like, where we are, or...?
One less place to fight. It's up to you. I couldn't care less.
To be fair, if we kill him, there'll also be one less person to fight.
And plus, there is the chance that if he does get away and out of this room, he could alert anyone else to get in there.
Fair enough.
Wait, but that means more mustaches to be drawn.
Okay, can I get the team conference to, like, what you think I should possibly do, considering my abilities?
So yeah, at this moment in time, you're standing there ready for something, but you're talking to the other members of the party, planning.
If you run
so
over here, if you run over here, you can borrow my dagger. I'll hold it back.
That's a good idea.
You've got that. Throw it.
Yeah. What say if I run over to the Garfield and just try and basically vibe my hand through him?
I like try to do the whole I gotcha.
Yep.
Okay, so you dash up to him and you go to do the hand vibrating into your chesty thing, and yeah, I want you to roll a d20 for it.
D20. Ah, crap, it's a 2.
Oh, and then add your... Because this involves intricacy of knowing how deep the armor goes and how deep the muscle and the layers of bones are, add your intelligence check on top of that.
Intelligence... Is that... That's plus 5, so that's 7.
So
pretty bad.
You dash up to him, and it's like, don't mind if I just check you out. Shaking your hand as it gets closer and closer and closer, and then it just, as you get closer, it just ricochets off of Shockjammer's armor, and you're just like, that normally works.
I imagined that you were just going to give him a gentle massage.
So like Garfield's looking at you, and he just looks at what your hand just did, and it ricocheted back. He's like, really? What school did you come from, weird arm man?
Sadly, okay, have I got any other options to do?
Sadly, no, that is your move, because you had to move towards Shockjammer because you were pushed back by the hammer-wielding dude earlier, and you tried doing the vibe into his chest. So, sadly, you're done at the moment.
Fair play.
Let's move you on to... It's the Jared versus Shockjammer roll. Jared, do your thing.
Okay, so I want to move as close as I can to Shockjammer.
Okie dokie. Just roll me a d20 first to see if you get higher than me, to see if you do go first before Shockjammer.
Okie dokie. 10.
Shockjammer got a 17. So
damn it!
You're on game, but not too on game. And so at this point, Shockjammer's now completely dumbfounded by everything that's happened. Like, he's just seen one of his royal guards killed right in front of him. He's had a strange, weirdly armored dude try to both hit him and do this weird vibing thing through his chest. And he still has a Death Knight, but it's pretty damn intimidating at this moment in time. Just with his sword pointed at the other dwarf who's running for his life. And he's just looking to himself saying, "Fine, I'll do this myself." And looks towards as much as he wants to clout Cole across the face, because he's relatively close. He's more dumbfounded than anything as to what Cole's doing, so he doesn't see him as a threat. But because Revan is standing as an intimidating presence, he wants to deal with you first. So he's going to come on in, hammer in hand, and try and bring down the pain. Wow. What was your armor class again?
That would be 15.
He rolled a 3! So he goes, "This is how you do intimidating!" And just, he swings, hoping to get a horizontal swing across your face. And he does it, and then thinks to himself, "Why did that not hit you?" He's still relatively far away from you. So he just literally swang at midair.
Isn't this like the second time you've tried this? Maybe you should just give up.
Well, at least I'm not like my guardsman. At least I'm actually trying to fight.
Well, calm down, Garfield.
And then behind you, you just hear the one dwarf who's really, really scared going, "I tried to help, sir." Shut up!
Do you still want lasagna, sire?
Right, Jared, now it is your turn. Go ahead and do what you want to do.
Okay, so I want to get as close to Shockjammer as I can.
Which you can, so that's part of your action. You've moved up. You are right in ahead of him, right close to him. He's just going to look at you and just go, "A golden-handed silver dragonborn? What? Seriously, are you guys from a carnival?"
Maybe.
Hey, I just got here.
To be fair, I've lived on a mountain like forever.
Maybe
so...
I'm your dad.
What did you say, Jared? I
said, "Well, maybe I'm his dad." Yeah.
You realise that has no effect on me. I know my father, and he is not Dragonborn, so you can shut up, you pathetic scum.
Okay, well, I want to hit him with my Warhammer then.
Okay, let's go. Roll me that d20. Plus, and then add on your attack bonus.
16.
Whoa. Let me just check. Is that hit with Shockjammer? Because he does have the shield up at this point in time. Oh, that's it. Oh, well done, Jared. That's a hit. Yeah.
Yes, something useful.
So you just swing, like, you just look at him saying, "Well, if I'm not your daddy, this baby is." Just swing the Warhammer down onto him, and it just smacks into one of his shoulder plates as he just rings from the pain of it all. Roll for damage.
Well, so that is 1d8.
Then I believe that's plus 2 because you're proficient with it.
It's 1 plus 3 bludgeoning.
Okay, so you've done 3 damage to that. I need to... Okay. Caliente. You've done some damage to him. You have bent that shoulder plate on his armor. congratulations, you have dealt damage, but Shockjammer is far from done yet.
Damn.
Well done on that, Jared. Next, Ryan!
Yes, sorry, I was Miles away for a second. I was focused on booze.
Well, it fits your character, so that's alright. So, you've caught your breath, you're ready to rush in there. If you were to rush in there now, you could be by the side of Revan and get ready for revenge on Garfield.
So we've only got the left guard and Garfield left to deal with, is this correct?
Pretty much. The left guard at this moment in time just has his back towards you guys and is heading off with no weapon, no shield, and trying to run for his life.
I wanna stop him before he then goes off to warn others then. That's what I want to do. So I want to go running towards him and rugby tackle him to the ground so he goes no further.
Because you're being a dwarf, this is going to be your whole action, but I want you to roll me a d20 plus your strength to see if you can get him over from the rugby tackle and pin him down on the ground.
So my d20 is 17 plus my modifier, which is 1, 2, 3, so 17, 18, 19, 20, so that's 17 plus, so it's 20 all in all.
Very nice. So you're thinking to yourself, I can do this, I can do this, and then you just have this great drunken idea in your head. You just point at the dwarf that's running for his life, and you're just like, Patriots coming!
Like a spectator, like, nah!
Pretty much. You charge at him, you grab him by his legs, take him down, and he is now face first onto the floor with you on top of him going, yay!
Nice one. So that's my whole turn made up now, isn't it?
Yes, that is.
Nice one.
Fantastic job. Right, so he is now pinned on the ground. So anything that you are to do at this moment in time on him will have advantage if you were to attack him or anything otherwise. So that's brilliant.
This is Shark Ammo.
And just so people at home are aware, yes, there's both my dad and the cat.
But I've got no more attacks, have I, Dom?
No, that is your entire action for the turn.
Okay.
Right, so moving on. That was Ryan. Let's see. Nine. Oh, it's Arwen! Ah, yes. Because he spent last term just looking at his legs, going, ah.
Like the Family Guy moment, like, oh, ah. Yeah.
Definitely.
Ah.
But now he stands up, bow at the ready, rings it back with an arrow, aiming straight for Shockjammer's head. And he's now going to try and shoot something into his eye. So let's see. You see, he rolls an 11 plus what he has for his weapon. So it's 11, 15, but he shoots against Shockjammer. And what that does is, he rings it back, shoots the bow, the arrow goes flying through the air, just seems to dodge and completely avoid where Revan is standing, but Revan just sees this arrow tip just go past him. Goes past and just careens straight into the right eye of Garfield, as he is now ringing back in complete pain and is now partially blinded from that strike. So I'm gonna roll damage for what Arwen just did, because that was amazing. And he did. He did 7 points of damage to this guy.
Nice! With the blade. Very nice!
Let's see. So,
how many hits have we got left in him? How's he got left in him?
So he's been struck back by this. He is now, like, careening back, bearing in mind he has an arrow in his eye. He just seems to be getting madder and madder and madder. He is not looking happy whatsoever, but it just looks as if this is giving him so much adrenaline, but he is not going down. This man is made out of sterner stuff than you guys even imagine. in the first place, and it's crazy.
I'm not focused on him, I'm focused on this other dwarf that I'm on top of at the moment.
Yeah, you're the sandwich dwarf, you just saw this arrow cream pass, and you're just like, thumbs up. Nice.
Just like, I love it!
And then,
I'm just focused on my soon-to-be new best friend.
Then you just then you just grab a flagon of ale, it's just like, I'll drink to that.
Yeah, pretty much. I drank to that, just like take a bit of my sip of beer out and back my cake.
Oh yeah. So that was nicely done. Let's see, who is next on my list? It's Nath!
Whee!
Halodynamo, right, let's go.
Yeah. So obviously that other dwarf that I was initially going for has been chased off and pinned down.
Yep.
Yeah, they're doing the Mr. Grey stuff. I'm just going to turn around and walk towards Shockjammer, and I'm going to take a swing at him, if I can do that.
Alright, you can do that, so roll me for that attack.
Okie dokie. Nice. 25. Natural 20.
Oh!
Radical!
Okay, so, the crit. You do max damage on your weapon, and I want you to roll me that damage again to add on top of max damage.
So I'm not adding my modifier again.
So you're adding you have your damage roll plus the proficiency modifier that goes with it normally.
Yeah. Okay. And that is 16.
16. Whoa. God. 16 points. You do. Okay. Whilst I'm doing the maths on this, explain to the entire party and the audience at home, how do you do this?
Oh.
Does he die?
Yeah.
He's not dead yet.
Oh.
But, how do you do it? How do you do this godlike damage swing?
So I'm just gonna like start charging up to him. Start sprinting up to him, just screaming, Shockjammer! But whilst I'm sprinting up to him, I'm dragging my axe across the floor. Sparks flying everywhere, and I just do a huge uppercut swing with my battle axe.
Oh, lovely. And that uppercut swing, literally, it crumples his beard up, smashes him in the jaw, careens him backwards so hard that he is now thrown backwards and is now on the floor in like a star pattern with this arrow sticking up from his lifeless body and what seems to be what you think was the death blow, but then you just see him just slightly twitching and twinkling here and there. He is pretty damn weakened at this point in time, and is now prone on the ground. Very nicely done.
Is that my full move, or can I still...
That was your full move. Cool. That one. Okay, so next up, we have everyone's favourite. It's the Runaway Dwarf, who is now pinned underneath Ryan at this point, so he has to do a strength saving throw to see if he can somehow roll over and get Ryan off of him. So what I want to do here is, I'm going to roll a d20. Ryan, you roll a d20 as well. Whoever gets highest wins this decision. So let's see what happens. My god. This was bad on my end. Well, how was yours?
4.
So, put it this way. I rolled a 2. So, like, he's trying...
It's like a wet noodle fight.
He's trying to roll around underneath you, and you're just sitting on top of him, legs crossed, with a bit of your ale, just drinking it very poshly. As if it's like, you won't be moving.
Yeah. He can't move.
He is very much pinned. Like, well done.
I suppose that's purely because of the amount of ale and just the weight of me being on top of him. He's just like, for fuck's sake, can someone get this massive hump off me?
Yeah, he's just like, can someone get him off? And he was like, nope.
Yeah.
Pretty much. And now, it is Craig.
Finally. Right. So, Shockjammer's still right for the picking.
Shockjammer's on the floor. Other dudes on the floor. Everyone's hit the floor. Everybody do the dinosaur.
Yeah.
Should we walk out the door next, Dom?
And we opened the door.
Wait, what?
Open the door, get on the floor, everybody.
Everyone do the dinosaur.
Oh, yeah. So,
yeah,
Craig, what are we doing?
I'm on the floor because I just crit the shit out.
Okay, so Craig, what are you planning?
Alright. But yeah, is he face up or face down?
He's face up. So the arrow face is up. Sticking up. Yeah. Star shape on the ground, him looking up. Oh.
Then you should push the arrow.
Well, he said he wanted to have the gnome.
Oh no.
Oh, he's gonna get the gnome alright.
Oh god.
And his massive stick.
Oh god.
He's getting teabagged.
No.
How are you gonna whack him with said stick?
Oh god.
You're gonna play golf with his golf balls.
Oh god.
You know what? I was gonna go with the whole putting the sword in the pedestal style, but now I wanna golf swing his head.
Alright, let's go for it. Friggin' roll me that.
Thank god there's no more sexual euphemisms.
Roll me the D. So you have advantage on this, so it's 2d20s, highest one wins.
Just for one's sake, let's hope it's not a 4.
2d20s, add roll.
And then this adds your attack hit bonus.
At a 1, so...
Whoa.
Well, that would be a 1. That would have been a 1 plus, whatever. But, 10 to 12.
12, right.
A lot of 12s today.
So you go up to his head, you ready your staff, just like you readied that swing with the rat, just what seems to be moments ago.
One big step forward, staff behind the head.
You do a proper golf swinger's back. Swing it down into his helmet, and as you swing it down into his helmet, it bangs, but it doesn't bang quite hard enough as the shake from that helmet just ricochets up the staff handle, and it just shakes you like out of a Looney Tunes episode where you're just like.
You do right. Hear the comedic relief from the gong.
Bong.
Gong.
Good thing, alright, and now, I've got bonus action as well.
Yep.
I'm just gonna kick him in the face at this point.
Okay.
But just stomp on him, just like, not my game.
And then just like roll like the heel of your foot into his nose to make sure of it. Nice. So,
yep.
So just get me a d20 on that one.
d20, where's it? 13 to 15.
Nice one. Oh, and you have advantage by the way, so you do another one.
Another one.
Another one.
15 compared to less than 15.
Okay, so you take your foot, you slam it onto the face of Shockjammer, just reeling your toe into his nose, as if to put it, your eye's gone, now your nose is gone. What you gonna do now, huh? Just reeling it in. Roll me, because he is lying on the ground, he has an arrow in his face and all that, roll me, because your foot has so much force behind it. I want you to roll me a D10's worth of damage.
A D10?
This is instead
of my D4 normally.
Yes,
normal
this is D4. A D10 instead. I'm giving you some power behind this one.
Ooh. 3. Damn it.
To the 3.
If that was on a D4, I'd be fine. D10.
Oh. So you deal 3 damage to him. He's now got blood careening from a broken nose that he has sustained. But you're still seeing movement in certain places of his body. He is not dead yet. For some weird, ungodly reason, he is not dead. And it's confusing for a lot of you. It's like, what the hell is this dwarf? What is this guy?
I'm some of the other dwarf, so I'm not really aware of this.
So it's like, okay. Vinny, it's your turn again.
Right, so if I was to use my Raise Undead on the right guy,
yep.
Do I have any other actions after that, or do I
You could move around, but that would be your main action.
Right, okay, right, so I want to raise this guy,
right.
And then as a bonus action, I want to run over, grab his head and throw it back at him and hope he catches it.
Oh, right, so you want to animate the dude you cut the head off, grab his head and then throw it. At Shockjammer,
yeah.
Who's lying on the ground.
No, not at Shockjammer. I want to
throw it back onto
the
body.
Right guard, so he can actually see what the fuck is going on.
Alright.
He wants to play catch with the zombie.
No, I want to help the zombie kill Shockjammer.
So you see
you're
these.
Playing catch with it.
You see these necrotic energies just coming from the tattoos on your arm as everyone now just feels this strange darkness in the room as this body is slowly just getting itself back up, digging both of its hands in the ground. getting itself back up, the head non-existent. And as it's just wailing about, and you just hear a rolling on the ground at this moment in time, it was like, and you throw the head onto the rest of the body of this zombie dude. And he's now just got his head grabbed between both of his hands, looking around with that undead look in his face, just like, you have reanimated the dwarf. Well done.
Woo!
Now, because he's reanimated and it's your turn, now do you want to move around before anything else happens?
I'll move back outside just in case anything does happen.
Okay, so but, you take like a good fair few steps backwards just to make sure.
Yeah, make sure I can keep an eye on everything, but I don't want to be caught in anything.
All right, no worries. So at this moment in time, because you summoned the zombie, it is your zombie dwarf's turn. So what I want you to do is, what would you command your zombie dwarf to do?
I would command him to go feast on the body of the left-hand dwarf.
So what I want you to do is, to make this a little bit interesting, roll me a d20 plus right. your intelligence modifier to see if he understands the command completely.
Right, I've rolled 14 plus my intelligence plus 3, so 17.
So he looks at you, like, gives like his, because he's holding his head at this point, his entire body just gives a nod of approval. He just slams the head back onto his shoulders, twists it by 360 degrees to make sure it's screwed back on properly. Look, like, just drags his body towards where Shockjammer is just laying on the ground. And the instinct that pops into his head is smash! And he goes head first into Shockjammer's balls.
Did say the left-hand dwarf, but...
Yeah,
I did. Oh, the left-hand dwarf. Okay, never mind. Goes towards the left-hand dwarf, and Rich literally...
headbutts his balls.
He jumps in between, like, that little arse crack, because he's down face first, and starts taking a good chunk out of his butt. So I want you to roll a d6 worth of damage.
Right. I rolled a 3.
Okay. So this guy is literally getting his ass eaten out at this point in time. And he's just on the ground going, what the hell is that on me? And Ryan, who's just still sitting on his back, is going, oh, it's nothing, just sit still. Like, you're a little bit...
Don't worry about it, it's nothing, it's fine.
Like, Ryan...
You're just sitting on your back, don't worry, it's like, okay. Ryan,
you're a little bit freaked out by it, but then you're just occasionally looking down at the zombie, just going, if you want any drink, mate, I've got it. Like, want to wash it down with anything, I've got it.
Something to quench your thirst, I can survive for that.
Pretty much, it's great stuff. So, that was Vinny's turn. So, Dan, up to you. Bear in mind, you have a fallen over shock jammer in front of you, and about a little ways away, you've got the other dwarf, who's now...
Could I move to shock jammer blindside?
Right.
Raise my greatsword in two hands, I believe. And then just cleave him with it, basically.
Wow. Like a downward cleave, I like.
Straight down into, like, the remnants.
All right. Right, so you have advantage on this. 2d20s, please.
Okay,
we're going to
come back.
Run away.
Sorry. I got a 15 and then an 11, so the 15. Do I add anything onto that?
You add your attack bonus onto that.
My attack bonus? Plus 3.
Let me see, that was 15 you rolled, yeah?
Yeah.
18. Lovely. Lovely, lovely. So you get into his blindside, obviously where the arrow is sticking out of his eye. You grab your greatsword, you ring it over your head, dig it down into the little place of where you believe his heart is at this moment in time, and it goes straight through. You see that a big like jolt of a reaction from his body as you have now hit him right where it hurts. Now, roll me the damage of your weapon.
It's 2d6.
Lovely.
So
double d6.
I got a 6 and a 2, but due to my great weapon fighting, when I roll a 1 or a 2, I can roll that again.
That's all right.
So that's a 6 and a 4. That's 10 damage.
10 damage. Is there any bonuses on that, or?
I'm not sure.
Because if you're proficient in great swords, that's a plus 2.
I believe I am.
So, okay, so what are the numbers again? Just remind me.
You got 10 plus 2.
Alright, so... 12! 12. Okay, so you're down by the... Oh my god. Right. You dug this sword straight down where his heart is. You wring it back out, seeing like blood splatter as it comes out of it. And yet somehow, because you're standing out in front of him, you realize death quite well. You're a death knight after all. Of course you recognize death. You stick the sword out and you just look down into where the hole is. There isn't a heart there.
Come on, Revan. That's just disappointing.
This is so fucked up.
And the strange thing is, you hit him exactly where the heart should be. So something's not quite right about this situation. And quite frankly, you're still seeing fingers and odd bits of his arm moving at this point.
Just wondering.
Yep.
What is Garfield's intelligence?
Garfield's intelligence? Give me one second. Doo-doo-doo. He has an intelligence of 9.
Damn. If he had an intelligence of 8, I could have tried to control him. If he doesn't have a heart, he must be undead.
Well, he isn't undead. There's something otherly about him, but one of you could always try and investigate it if you wanted to on your turn when it comes up.
Could I investigate the hole?
I'll let you do that as a bonus action because you did the hole in the first place. So roll me a d20 and an investigation check.
Okay, 7.
So you look into this hole where the heart should be, and you're thinking to yourself, "Oh heart, where are you?"
There should be a fucking heart here, but there's not. Guys,
you're not. So you're not seeing the heart in there, but occasionally you just see like an odd bolt of electricity just fly past where this hole is. You're starting to realise that his heart may have been removed, and he may have had some strange surgery done on him to make it so that he's now living via magic alone.
Well, that was one hell of a shock.
Hey!
Shocking.
Is that why it's called Shockjammer?
Okay, so let me see. That was Dan. Then we have Cole. Your turn.
Well, I'm just thinking, just by Dad's investigation, maybe I should look a bit further into this, like through my history abilities and...
You can? Totally. So, roll me a d20, add your history check to it.
Right, 20... Oh, wow, that's pretty bad. 1. bad with dice.
So, You go back into the library of your head trying to picture if you've seen something like this before sometime in history, maybe through like old medical records that you read up when you were a philosopher, and you generally just think to yourself, nothing's there. No, lost it.
Yeah, but it's plus 5, so it's a 6, but still it doesn't matter.
Yeah.
But is that all one?
No, that will just count as a little bit of a bonus action for you. So you can still move in, you can still smash whoever you want, whether it's Eat Out Zombie Dwarf or Shockjammer. Yep.
Would I still be able to, like, well, vibe in a sense?
You could vibe. The only thing is, you don't know what's quite in there. If a heart's not there, what are you going to vibe into?
His head.
His nutsack.
Bloody hell.
His skull. The head.
So you want to vibe the head?
Is that the chocolate pudding? Now he's going for the berries.
When you go for the back passage, go for a bit of a real shock jammer.
Ooh. Okay, so, Cole, you run, you dash over to where his, like, he's lying with his eye, still, one of his right eye still jammed with the arrow, him lying back, emotionless at this point, completely emotionless. And your hand just starts vibing again, saying, time for some surgery. As your hand just starts going downward into his scalp. I want you to roll me a d20. And then add your intelligence on top of it, because you're doing the whole vibe thing again for him.
Right, so I've got 11 and plus... is that the big number or the plus number?
The plus number.
Is that a saving throw or the other one?
Other one.
That's 11 plus 3, so that's 14.
So you go in, you're... Because he's... Oh wait, it's advantage. So you have to roll... You can roll another d20 to see if you get higher.
Okay.
So we'll do that first.
18.
Oh, very nice. So you're doing you're doing your shaky hand speedster thing, dig into his scalp, and you can feel brain matter in here. But the brain matter just seems to be enchanted by some kind of lightning that you can just feel surge up you. Of course, it doesn't damage you because you are the speedster. You're used to the electricity given off by the speed force. But you can feel some kind of weird electrical energy coming off of his brain, that's not normal electrical brain waves. Now that you have your hand in his head, what do you want to do with the hand in his head?
Right,
spare him as a fucking puppet.
Skins. I don't know if I have this ability, but what if I were to try and like sync my lightning energy with his and see if I could like combine his with my own and take it. Like,
ooh. You know what? This is such an interesting idea. I will just about let you try it. See if you can't absorb this electrical energy that's coming through him. What I want you to do is, I want you to roll me a d20, and I want you to add your wisdom modifier on top of it this time, because now you're using all of your known know-how of the speed force to channel this through your body so you're not damaged or eradicated or even shocked back by it.
Okay, fingers crossed, everybody. Roll a 20, and it's plus 1 on wisdom, so 21.
Critical!
Nice! Right. So, the electrical energy, you feel it inside the brain. You grab part of the cerebral cortex that seems to be like the epicenter of all this energy. You latch onto it and grab it as if you're grabbing onto the hilt of a dagger. And as you have, all that energy just starts caressing through your arm and throughout the rest of your body. And at this point, the other party members could just see you occasionally flash or glow this strange yellow electrical surge of power that's just going through you all. As while this is all happening, Shockjammer's body, from his face all the way down to the individual bits of his body that you can see in between his armor, is just slowly being sucked of all the life that seems to be in it. And by the time you take your hand out and you just squeeze your fist to realize that all this energy has just been absorbed into you and the speed force, you look back down to where Shockjammer is, and he just seems to be completely sucked of all life force. Not quite like how the zombie is, where the zombie's undead. Because he's not undead, he's just sucked. Like he's empty on anything that could be running him right now. So you have basically sucked him dry.
Oh my.
Now, the trick is... Well, because of all this has happened... It would be Shockjammer's turn next, but because of the events that have just happened now, you start, like, Shockjammer's lifeless, like, Shockjammer is dead at this moment in time, because you can all see that there is no way that this being, after you've stabbed him, you've stomped him, you've done this to him, he is never getting up ever again. Even if he wants to, he's so lifeless, there's no chance he will ever do that again. And then you start realizing something. In the front chest plate of his armor, something just latches open and opens up on his chest piece. And there just seems to be like a flashing orb. Just a tiny little flashing orb just in his chest piece. But this orb is blinking. and it seems to be blinking more and more rapidly the longer it stays. I want every single person.
Hang on, quickly, I want to pick it up.
Craig, just before you
can I quickly use my skill in Arcana to see if I can recognize it?
This is the thing, just before Craig does what he wants to do, I want all of you to roll me an Arcana check.
Why me? I'm not going to him!
Oh boy!
You can still see like this 20? Weird red glow.
A what check?
Arcana.
Who's that? 12 minus 1, 11.
Arcana skills from your intelligence.
So I got four.
Natural 20.
I actually rolled a 1 minus 1.
I do so much better roll a 0.
You have no idea.
Yeah, I got 11 on that one.
Yeah. Nice one.
I got 4.
Everyone,
17 plus 1.
Everyone who was able to roll a 10 up, you know, you see this gem that's now gradually flashing more and more and more, and you realize that this is a very rare magically enchanted item that is blinking because the owner of said item's life force has genuinely left his body, and because of this, this gem has activated. And from your knowledge of how magic works and how the energies inside of this gem is working, you have about 2-3 turns between all of you to get the hell out of this building, or else this thing's gonna go boom boom and take you all down with it.
So don't use it as a
goal. The first thing I said before the kind of checks was, I'm getting the fuck out of there. So I'm already halfway up the stairs by now.
guys, I have an idea.
Can I ask my undead to run with it away from us while we go the other way?
No, wait. Are there any windows?
There are windows.
Can we... the undead jump out a window with a bomb? That'd be great.
That would destroy... Would that not hit the bottom of the building, causing it all to topple anyway?
It may not cause the building to tumble. But something else may happen.
Wait.
I don't know.
Wait, before we do anything... Can I get some charcoal from Dan and draw a mustache from Shockjammer?
Jared, roll me a d20 on that.
12.
You go up to Dan, and Dan's like, are you feeling what I'm feeling? Yeah, give me the charcoal. Slap the charcoal into your hand. You go up to Shockjammer, and you're just like, doo-doo-doo, doing a little bit of an
arty... At this point, I'm out the door.
Doing a bit of an arty twist. All you've done is you've just put a mustache on his forehead, not where it's supposed to go.
Also, can I pick up his golden hammer?
You can. So you go down, you pick up his hammer, and as you do, the hammer reacts with your golden hand, as if something's not quite right with it, and the hammer itself explodes in your hand.
Wow.
You take 3 points of damage.
Wow, now I'm 6 HP.
And there's no more hammer. So well done. Yeah.
Well.
Is there a way to pick up the crystal?
There is, like, because you... Did you succeed in the Arcana check?
I did not.
Well, the other party members that did do realize that with this gem, if you were to move it, it would not trigger it to prematurely explode. However, if this came in contact with the floor or any other surface, it may trigger it prematurely. So it can be lifted and carried, but it can't be dropped or thrown.
So you're saying that I could lift it, I could carry it to a window, I could throw it, but if I roll low, like I usually do,
you're gonna go boom boom.
You're gonna go bye bye.
Then this is no time for roll. How big is it?
In comparison to the size of the room we're in, how big is the explosion gonna be?
Because you succeed in your con check, you can roughly estimate that the explosion will be roughly the diameter of where you guys are around Shockjammer, in about a 50-foot circular radius around you all.
I'm still running out the door.
If anyone wants to listen.
Yeah, I'm getting the fuck out of Dodge.
How? Oh, I just had a really crafty idea.
Oh no.
Right, now, just hear me out. I'm going to do this in Bernard, because I'm a sadistic bastard. That guard, right? He's still lying there, yeah?
Yeah.
How about stuff it in the back of it, back of his armor, and let him free? And don't let him know. Don't let him know. Just let him run.
Could do that.
We may not have the time to do that, though. Because obviously,
I know that I'm sending him
just
like
three rounds worth.
Guys.
Yes.
Is it possible to stick it to one of us?
Like me?
And then wait.
Run out of thing?
Well, no, because then wouldn't we have basically a magical time bomb for if one of us dies?
Well, you only have a limited amount of time before this bomb goes off anyway, so there's really no point.
Just give it to the speed guy and just have him run.
Run, motherfucker, run!
So, you know, I'm setting this as a timer on my phone and putting it up to the can. So hopefully the can will detect this. You have roughly 5 minutes starting from now.
I'm already out the door.
So the paladin is literally, fuck this shit, I'm out. And he's just getting out of there.
Yo, speedster.
Useless bloody paladins, always. Useless.
I want to pick up the crystal and throw it out of the window. I'm just like, you know, fuck this shit. Just like, you know what? If no one's going to do any shit, I'm drunk enough and crazy enough and I could not fucking care. I'm just going to waddle straight over to Shockjammer, pick up that crystal and just go, fuck it, and walk towards a window, punch a window and throw that crystal out.
Well, if you give me 2 milliseconds, I could explain my idea.
Okay, so you're readying to throw this gem. As you do, the speedster just runs up to next to you and is just like, yo, hold on. So, Cole, what's your idea?
Yo, bro.
Right, I have 2 ideas. One, I combine it with myself, therefore I become its new host, considering I have the same life force and the same energy that he had once in him, therefore it wouldn't explode, because then it would be not nuclear and not reacting to something that it shouldn't. Or, I take it and throw it into the speed force itself. The speed force will be able to take it and turn it into conservative energy and make it more of the speed force.
it involves going fast. My old master taught me to does have a preference of going fast. Do it.
I'll just
for the sake
have
of
a
fast.
Thought, completely unrelated to this really painful looking gem, has anyone actually tended to Arwen yet? Or is he still lying there with his leg in
like Arwen? Arwen's leg is a bit damaged, but he's well enough to walk. He's looking at you going, my friends, we're running low on time here. If this is what I think it is, we have to get out of this building right now.
I want to still throw the goddamn gem out of the way so we don't need to worry about it. So like, you guys...
Okay, I'm doing my idea. I don't care. I'm fastest. I'm going to do what I want.
Just so you know, you got about 3 minutes.
I'm doing it.
So Speed Force steal the gem. Okay, I'll let the Speed Force steal the gem, and you know what? I'm just going to peg it out the door.
I'm already on the outside of the other door, just smoking a medieval cigarette.
What if we were to tie it to one of Arwen's arrows?
You could do that. It's an option.
Consume it. Let him consume it. If he dies, he dies. I don't care. I don't have enough time for this shit. I need more booze in my system. Fuck it. I'm out of here. I want more booze.
Right. Yes?
I'm going to go for the second idea.
Okay, so you're going to try and throw it into the speed force.
Yep.
Right, so you...
Alright, so I'm going to run about 100 miles away.
Yeah.
With it. Just make sure it doesn't drop or anything, and then throw it into the speed force after I've hit top speed.
Dom?
Yes?
Wouldn't he have to roll a dexterity check for that shit?
Though? Which he is going to, so...
Yay!
Cole, I need you to roll a d20. I'm warning you, because you're throwing this into the speed force, which needs to be high.
Yeah, but...
Okay, 20. Here we go. 7.
So you dash out about 100 odd miles away. You dash back into the building. And you're like, bye bye, Crystal! You throw it, hopefully into the Speed Force, but instead you throw it through a window that lands on the other side, like still inside of a building, but lands on the other side. And now, you've got about a minute shaved off. You are now looking at getting out within the next 40 seconds.
Oh no!
But I want to make sure I've got shades on and like watching the explosions go off like a, like walking out and they're just like, cool guys don't look at explosions, they simply walk away.
So are you guys getting out of a building at this point?
Dom?
I've been out for the past 5 minutes.
Bear in mind, you have like 20 seconds.
I want to run for my life.
What if I...
Yeah, we have the gnome in my hand.
No!
Still fully in danger of the crystal exploding on us now.
Someone pick up Arwen, make sure he's dragged out then.
I'm pretty sure Arwen's already leg going.
Wait, so it flew out the window into another part of the building.
Get the guard and throw him on top of the crystal, see if he can dampen the blow.
I'm jumping out the window.
Well,
yeah, I'm jumping out the window.
Well, as you guys have been conferring about this whole mess, you hear a big explosion in the room next to you.
Oh, crap.
But luckily, it's been thrown enough into that room where the explosion itself won't hurt you, and the building seems to stay up enough, and you're all looking at each other just going, woo, until you start feeling a shake from above, and now the ceiling is starting to collapse down.
I'm sure those things with my shades on, just like, cool, just don't look at explosions, they simply walk away.
Who was saying me, yeah?
Okay, finally, thank you for saying this since we had about 30 seconds remaining. What are the chances of survival if I dive out a window?
If you dived out a window at the last minute, which I'll allow...
Yes. Like,
I would allow anyone to do if you wanted to jump out a window at the last minute. You would all jump out the window, and then you would have to roll an acrobatic save to make sure that you don't get damage after landing out the window.
Acrobatics. Would that be a dexterity saving throw?
That would be, yes.
Was it actually an acrobatics check? On your skills.
Yeah. Sorry. Acrobatics check.
20 plus acrobatics.
Yeah, so are we all jumping out of windows at this point? Bearing in mind the only one...
I'm walking out the building with like shades on.
Like, the only two people that have walked out of the building casually not looking at the explosion is the paladin and the barbarian dwarf. But it's really sharing an ale, just going...
Me and the gnome have dived out the window.
And me.
Okay, so everyone's diving out windows, right, so...
Other than the two dwarves.
Jared, Dan, Craig, Vinny, and Cole.
Me, I'm holding on to.
Wait, Cole, what are you saying?
I'm holding on to the one that everyone said to look after.
Oh, to Arwen, so you're dashing, you're jumping out with him. Alright, no worries.
Yep.
Right, I want you all to roll for acrobatics.
Perfect. What dice are rolling? 20.
So that's a d20 plus your acrobatics.
I rolled a 15.
I rolled a 70.
Plus two.
19 plus 10, 12 again. What is it with 12s today?
I got 6.
I got 23 altogether.
Oh, nice. Right, so Arwen succeeded as well. So Arwen, Dan, Cole, Vinny, you're all fine. You land it. You're just like, woo! And then you look behind you, and then there's just the Dragonborn and the gnome. Just like slightly covered in a bit of dust and a bit of rubble, and they're just like, why did we wait so long? So,
guys?
So what we're going to do here is, Jared, what was the number you rolled?
6.
Oh dear.
Oof.
Oh boy.
I might kill Jared. Oh god.
Am I dead?
Oh, Jared, you're lucky. You take 1 damage.
Oh.
And only
yay.
1 damage.
Come on,
Jared,
5.
How much life do you have left?
5 HP.
And Craig, you take 3 points of
damage.
I rolled
another 12. I take 3. Oh boy.
I'm assuming me and obviously the barbarian would have noticed that those guys would have jumped out the window.
Oh yeah.
Oh no.
Like, yeah. You're all out of a building. Congratulations, guys. You slew Garfield Shockjammer. You escaped from an explosion, and you have successfully escaped from Malcomite Prison!
Well done, guys.
And as you're celebrating, you're high-fiving each other, bro-hugging, like chugging drink beer, having a good ale mustache session.
Drawing.
As all I'm this is happening, confused. As all this
can
is happening,
on one of my energizing crystals to like keep me like energized.
Oh yeah, like you're like still powered up with like that energy you absorbed. Any of that damage you took from that last fight is recovered now, so you're right. Now the thing is, all you guys are celebrating, you're dusting yourselves off, you're having a good time, you're like, yes, we're out. And as you're celebrating, each and every one of you gets hit by something you can't quite control. It seems to be a very strong pressure inside of your minds that systematically knocks each and every one of you out. But as your eyes are slowly closing, I want you all to roll me a d20 for a perception check to see if you can see who is doing it.
A 12 for myself. Oh, hang on, I forgot to add my modifier, sorry. Perception.
18 plus
3,
so I've got
21. I rolled 19 in total.
Perception. 11.
What's perception off again?
Wisdom.
I rolled a
1.
And you've got minus 4.
Minus 4
you see nothing!
He's rolled a minus 3.
Craig's just asleep, right?
Dog.
I rolled a 16.
Okay, so...
Dog, do I take off my wisdom modifier that's in bold, in like the overall shape? Or do I take off the skill one?
If it's perception, you do it off the actual skill of perception.
Okay, fair enough. So then that's just natural 12, that is, then.
Alright.
I got 19.
Cole, what did you get?
I rolled a 16 plus perception 1. So 17.
Nice.
Well, I rolled a 21.
Nice one. So the majority of you do catch a glimpse of what's happened, but Craig's asleep. He's just gone.
I'm just looking up at this.
Just before you guys get systematically knocked out, you see a group of like 4 individuals cowled but have their faces covered. But one of them doesn't have their face covered nearly as much. It just seems to be a very hefty dwarven guy with a big brown beard. But that, guys, I'm afraid, is all we have time for this evening. That is where we are ending. Cliffhanger of the century. But, ladies and gentlemen, thank you for watching this installment of D6. If you want to see more, be sure to check out the playlist that is on the channel. Also, if you want to keep updated as to what's going to happen next in the world of D6, be sure to follow us on the Facebooks, the Twitters, and all that fun stuff. I have the details
follow
in the description below.
On,
Thanks, Ryan.
That's pretty much me when I went and uppercut the shit out of Shockjammer, man. That's pretty much me.
@D6_follower.
Yes.
On Twitter.
Because if you want to follow the follower, you can.
The follower does not follow you, but you follow the follower.
That's how it works. And until next time, guys, we will be seeing you as we roll for initiative next time on D6. Say goodbye, everyone.
Bye, guys.
Bye.
Bye.